for coming out to see us. I know you guys have busy lives and donating your time like this to come and help us with our project and learn about some very interesting work that's going on here on Maui is an investment. So we thank you for making that investment. I know I can see some familiar faces up there. I know many of you have donated to our organization. Can you raise your hand if you're a donor? Yeah, we've got a good number of you. If any of you would like to join that group, the donation box starts there. We'd love to have you, the line will start on the right-hand side after the presentation. Okay, so I'm Larry Stevens. I'm on the board of the Maui Nui Marine Resource Council, and I'm gonna get us started tonight. So this is our mission. We're working for healthy coral reefs, clean ocean water, and abundant native fish all across Maui County. We're here tonight at the, with the help of the Maui Ocean Center. This is their facility. They are donating their facility to us, and they've done that for many times before, and we have a great partnership with them. They're a wonderful supporter. One of the things that they have just introduced is a presentation about Kahoa Lawe, which is one of our islands here in Maui Nui, and has gone through a fairly traumatic experience recently because of a big wildfire over there. You may have heard about something like 30% of the island is just caught on fire in the last week or so. But anyway, this is a long story, beautifully told. I encourage you to come and see it. A couple of program updates for you. At the end of January, one of our programs really got underway. We put 500 oysters in the water in Ma'alaya Harbor. And the good news is that they didn't die, because the water in the harbor is pretty dirty. In fact, that's the reason we put the oysters in the harbor, because oysters are water cleaners. A mature oyster can filter about 50 gallons of water per day and take all the grunge out of it, all the oil, all the silt, all the heavy metals, take it all out of the water, wrap it up in their mucus, and drop it on the bottom of the ocean where it doesn't interfere with anything again. Really cool. We're monitoring it, and we're going to be increasing our population of oysters. 500 is just the start. We're also working uphill here in Ma'alaya in the Pu'akea watershed. We have, we've gotten our a grant from the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, and we're beginning to do work on projects that cause and worsen runoff, which causes a lot of the pollution and sediment that goes into Ma'alaya Harbor and Ma'alaya Bay. We want to make that water cleaner so that we can achieve that mission of healthy reefs, abundant fish, and clean water. In addition to the Pu'akea program, where we've been doing this for a couple of years now, monitoring water quality all up and down the leeward side of Maui. We monitor 41 sites using volunteers primarily, and our program produces an enormous amount of data, all of which goes into the official state database. So we are contributing to the broader understanding of what's going on in our waters here in Maui. The bad news, of course, is that every one of the sites that we test violates the state water quality standards in some way or other, all 41 of them. So we've got some work to do there. The oysters are just a start. We also do a lot of education. You may have gone through Maui Airport recently, and you've seen some very bright, colorful signs that we put on the windows over there to help our visitors understand how they can make a little difference in making this a better island, to protect our reef, to protect our fish. And we're going to continue our coral reef and marine education program. We've got some more things coming this year that I won't tell you about tonight, but it should be pretty cool. A new thing that we're getting involved in is pesticide and herbicide issues. We're an agricultural state. We put a lot of pesticide and herbicide and fertilizer onto our fields for agriculture and for other things like golf courses and the flowers we have in our yards. So we're beginning to do education projects around that so that we can minimize the impact of those substances on our island and on our nearshore waters. Okay, enough of Maui Nui Marine Resource Council. Let's talk a little bit about our speakers. And I want to digress here slightly, because I want to tell you about next month's event. Next month, we're having Daniel Amato from the University of Hawaii come and talk to us about some of the advanced water quality monitoring work that he has been involved in. In particular, he's trying to figure out what we can do, what the impact of, and what we can do about cesspools. And cesspools are a big issue here on the island of Maui. We have, and in the state of Hawaii, we have more cesspools here in our state than anywhere else in the United States. Pretty big problem, pretty serious problem. This next presentation will come on April 1st at 5:30 here at the Sphere. Admission will still be free as it is tonight. Little administrative announcement, the bathrooms are over there. Please just go out the door and make it and turn to your right, and you'll be able to find them as you need them. Please no eating or drinking in the theater tonight. No, we're trying to be good citizens for the Ocean Center and have them keep inviting us back. Okay. So tonight's speaker is Mark Deakos. Mark came to Hawaii in 1996 to complete his master's degree at UH, studying humpback whales and then getting his Ph.D. studying manta rays. He later founded the Hawaiian Association for Marine Education and Research, which is a 501c3 nonprofit dedicated to protecting Hawaii's marine resources. After two decades of marine science and describing the degradation of our natural resources caused by the increasing threats of unsustainable growth, he switched his focus to solutions. He has just taken a new role as Chief Sustainability Officer for 3P Consulting. His ambition is to connect business owners, developers, planners, and decision makers with sustainable regenerative solutions that not only eliminate the threats, but allow us to restore the damage that we've caused to these beautiful places. And with that introduction, Mark, come on out.
Okay, we'll go with this. So I'm going to start tonight. Thank you, Larry. Appreciate that. This is the coolest venue I've ever gave a talk in. So thank you, Maui Ocean Center and MNMRC for having me tonight. But this quote, we do so much to prepare our children for the future, but are we doing enough to prepare the future for our children? Okay, I put this up here and I'll end with this quote because that's pretty much what inspires what I do and relates to why what I'm going to talk to you about tonight is so important. So I came to Hawaii from Canada about a quarter century ago. Did lots of work in the marine environment, humpback whales and manta rays, as Larry mentioned. And more recently evolved into a role of sustainability consultant with 3P Consulting. And I'm also an ambassador for the International Living Future Institute. That's what gives me the authority to talk to you about regenerative growth tonight. But I want to start, I want to take a step back. You can all thank Anne, said we got to bring in some charismatic fauna into this talk or nobody's going to show up. So you can thank her for doing this. So we'll start with actually some video. It's probably easier to show how amazing these animals are, what we see out there under the water. And okay, let's start with this one. So while I was actually started doing my PhD with humpbacks, but I was going and diving at the Olawala Reef regularly, and I had heard they were there, and there's manta rays are, they're pretty solitary. The only time you'll see them in groups and really be able to study them is to find places they aggregate, and they aggregate in two places. One is around cleaning stations, much like sharks and turtles. They go to get the little parasites removed from their bodies, and that's what Oluwalu provides them, is those Hawaiian cleaner ass. They kind of work, they're the colorful ones, they kind of work the inside of the mouth, inside of the gills, and you'll see those saddle ass kind of work on the outside. And so it was a great place. Probably 9 out of 10 dives there, I would find manta rays. They have a unique spot pattern on their belly. So just like a whale's tail, you can photograph it and capture that unique individual. I started developing a catalog of the manta rays that were visiting that reef by taking photographs of the underside of their belly. And over time, we developed the largest database of manta rays in the US. So over 400, I think we're up to 460 individuals. So the other unique thing about Oluwalu, and you don't see this rarely in any place around the world, are the mating trains that occur there. And the mating train, again, very similar to humpbacks, you get the female is sexually dimorphic, so is actually much bigger than the males. And she will lead a group. And you might see one female and a male following her, or up to, I've seen up to 28 males following a single female. Now, they don't battle each other like you would see in the humpbacks. They physically fight. I've never seen them actually fighting each other. I think it's more of an endurance rivalry. So these mating trains may go on for a couple of days, and there's probably a fitness level for those males that can sustain being with her that whole time, that can carry on. I don't know how much feeding goes on during these, but there must be some mechanism where she's differentiating males and choosing to mate. Now, I've never seen mating. I've seen a couple of videos, rare videos of it, and we've never seen pupping, where the females that give birth to a single pup every 2 to 3 years on average, again, very similar to whales. One 4-foot pup that's rolled up like a burrito in there and after about a 12-month gestation. So you can see the female in the front leading, and the males, a lot of very linear a lot of times. So even if you're at the back of the row and she turns around and is closer to you in the back, the males seem to still stay within that train, that linearity. So they get to be about 12 feet, the females, and about 10 feet are the males. That's a female coming through. I can tell because there's no claspers. They all have the pelvic fins, but the males you'll see have claspers. They look like cigar-shaped appendages. And if they extend past the pelvic fin, you know they're mature males. And all of these in here are mature males. And the great thing about doing research on these, they're very curious animals. So when that female sees the diver, she usually comes right over my head. All the males follow, so I can get ID, 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 one after the other. It's great. Great opportunity. The way they mate, they'll actually bite onto the left pec fin. They don't have teeth, but they have a plate on the upper ridge. So I can tell a female, if she's recently mated, if she's got a little scarring on that left pec fin. And then they'll kind of wrap around, they'll kind of stop motionless, sometimes sinking to the bottom, and they'll insert one of those claspers into her cloaca. It's very brief, but it's an amazing thing to see. And this was a fairly common occurrence. The winter time, again, similar to whales, were the main mating season from December to April. And you can see the female in the front on this one. See how bulbous she is? She's a pregnant female. She's probably going to give birth in a few weeks. And we've seen captive animals in the Okinawa Aquarium where right after a birth occurred, they actually mated. So that's probably why they're following her. And I've seen humpbacks do that, follow a pregnant female, wondering why are they staying with her when she's pregnant. But seems like immediately after birth, they will attempt to mate. So I do have citizen scientists, a lot of them here. We have a database online where you can add your photos, see if they are new animals or if they match the catalog. And like I said, over 480 individuals, and the photographs match all over Maui. So I know Maui Nui. So we know they use the Four Island region. Now here's a story of Noelani. Somebody mentioned it may be her back in Maui Harbor. But all of these animals I measured. I had a way to measure them with paired laser photogrammetry. None of them were young, small animals. So there was an entire cohort I was missing in my population. And when I got notified, this is Maui Harbor here, I jumped in and measured this one. This is Noelani. And it was the smallest one I've ever measured. And I'd never seen feeding here on Maui. We see it a lot on the Big Island. She was she was feeding. That's me taking measurements. I have two little laser pointers that I'll measure back home on the computer. So I actually got a tag on her as well to see, and she did go into Malaya Bay, which where for a long time I suspected that was where they were pupping. So manta rays will pup in kind of a secluded area, and then as those young animals mature, they start to expand their range out. And in 2017, I started getting calls about a bunch of manta rays sighted in South Maui. And I rushed down there, measured some again. It was all the little guys that I hadn't seen for 12 years of research. I did not know where the young animals were. Why they started appearing there, I don't know. They were feeding. This is me dragging a plankton net. You see that reddish material in there? Those are all the little plankton that they're feeding on. They're copepods. Put them under a microscope. It's also what the fish are picking off their backs, oddly enough, the little white specks. So it was great. The last couple of years, I think we have almost 40 new young individuals. This is a tagged animal just to see what their range is. They seem to hug that coastline pretty good. And so it'll be a lot later in life when they start to branch out and use the entire Maui Nui area like the adults. And then in 27, I got a report of Tala. Tala is our most famous manta ray that was using a cleaning station in Honolulu. And again, she was a young one and very, very curious. So sometimes you'll see dolphins or whales kind of go upside down. What they're doing is they're trying to put both eyes on you so you can they can see depth, right? You close one eye, you don't get that depth perception. And she would stay like that for minutes on end, just right below you, looking at you. They have the biggest brain-to-body ratio of all the fish. Now, that's generally for social animals where you have a lot of cognitive ability, so we're not sure why they have such large brains. But they definitely have that curiosity. There's something unique about them versus a shark that comes by. They have kind of a blank stare. Something more going on there. We don't know why that is occurring. This is her sinking to the bottom, upside down. Pretty cool. So unfortunately, among all of that great stuff, there are some not so great scenes. There's a lot of entanglement out there in fishing line, especially a lure fishing line. The hooks get embedded in the cephalic fins. They can be severed. 1 out of 10 animals have a severed or impacted cephalic fin. Those are the fins they use to funnel the plankton and the water into their mouth. So we don't know how that affects them. This is a boat running over a manta. So boat strikes can be an issue for them. This is the seawall we built at Ukamahami, right offshore of their cleaning station. There was a huge sediment plume from that. Probably a lot of the sediment out there, which is really bad. It's kind of sort of having a big impact on the reef. Here I'm taking a sediment core near the cleaning station. You'll see all that fine silt that just kind of floats there. That's an indicator it's from its land base. It's terrigenous. This is Honolulu Bay after a heavy rain. You know, with the way we're treating our lands, the way we're using our lands, we're causing them to bleed, basically, like this. A lot of it is sediment, detrimental to the reef, suffocating the reef. A lot of it's carrying pesticides, herbicides, fertilizers, all kinds of chemicals that we use in our design, in our urban planning, urban growth, and all of that runs into the shorelines and is having a massive impact on the reefs. So kind of unfortunate. I was seeing more of the degradation of the reefs, seeing a lot of impacts on the manta rays and all of that. We have Oluwalu right next to one of the best reefs on Maui. They've been trying to develop that for years. They're trying again. And these are the sighting rates since I started in 2005, dropping drastically. And these are the skunk rates. How many dives? I could do 9 out of 10 dives and see manta rays. Now, maybe 1 out of 20 I'll see manta rays. So That's where I got thinking, you know, I feel like the more I do this, I'm just documenting more and more of the decline and the devastation. Every time I give talks, you know, I have to say how worse it's gotten. And I started thinking, you know, I need to focus on the solutions more. I need to figure out, I need to connect the people that are perhaps unwillingly doing the damage, or maybe in our day-to-day lives. How do I get them connected? What solutions do exist? And how can I bridge that gap? How can we start implementing them? So I'm not going to spend too much time talking about the bad stuff, right? We all know we've lost 50% of our reefs in the last 2 to 3 decades. Larry mentioned the water quality in Maui, some of the worst in the state. These are all designed. This is what we designed, right? We didn't come here and inherit this. Our streams are dried up. On the social side, we have traffic, healthy food, just access to healthy local food is hard to come by. And of course, we all know about the affordable housing and just the cost of living here, all issues that we've created. We've designed these into our lives, and they're our own doing. So in my research for solutions, I came across this guy, Jason McClellan, and I watched this TED Talk, and I was blown away. He is an architect, frustrated, as most of us are, at why are we doing things the way we do it, and isn't there a better way? And he looked at a flower, right, and he thought, okay, a flower is locked in place, right? It gets all its water from the sky, from the ground, gets all its nutrients right from there. It cannot move. There's no toxins. It lives harmoniously with its environment. It reacts to the sun. It opens and closes depending on the environment, and so on and so forth. And it's beautiful. And he said, why can't we design buildings like that? You know, instead of designing a building that uses less fossil fuels, maybe they use no fossil fuels. Maybe if they use less impact on the water, maybe they generate, they capture and treat all of the water on site. Maybe there's no toxins. So we're very familiar with design, low impact designs, right? We understand we're having an impact, so we do low impact. Or the high standard LEED, right? LEED. These aren't necessarily good. They're less bad. They're controlling our impacts, right? So is that the high standard we want to set, where we're doing less bad, we're still doing bad? So Jason was thinking, how do we get to the right side of the curve? And he founded the International Living Future Institute and came up with these living building, living community frameworks, okay? Using the flower as a metaphor. And even came up with these living products, which I'm not going to talk about tonight. And I thought, that's crazy. You know, LEED platinum is just impossible to reach. You know, how are you ever going to get a net positive, regenerative building? So this is the Bullitt Center in downtown Seattle. And it is, it's a 6-story Class A office building. All composting toilets. They generate all of their own energy. They capture all of their water, treat it all on site. They do all of it, and they do it at the cost of regular building. So they proved that a building that's 90% bigger than everything else in the country, in probably the least sunniest state in the lower 48, they generate 150% of their energy needs. So they prove that it is possible. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about tonight, the ingredients that go into a living building. They basically broke it down. This is 20 years of research. They broke it down to 7 categories. They call them petals, conveniently. Place, water, energy, health and happiness, materials, equity, and beauty. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on these, but I want you guys to get the gist of it. Embedded under these are 20 criteria or 20 imperatives that represent regenerative or net positive growth. And this is not only a philosophy or an advocating tool, it's the highest standard of certification. And it's performance-based. That means a year after you your building has to perform as promised. It's very rigid. So let's start with place. Okay, the idea here is to restore a healthy coexistence with nature. There are four imperatives under place. Imperative one, limits to growth, is essentially you cannot build on intact ecosystems. So wetlands and primary dunes and floodplains, you can't, even on ag land, you have to build your footprint around existing brown spaces and infrastructure. So it's very important. Basically, smart growth, preventing sprawl. So we want to keep as much of the sensitive lands that we're losing rapidly, keep those intact as much as possible. All the landscaping around the property has to emulate what existed there before contact. So there's not just grass and ornamentals, you're recreating the ecosystem services that used to be there. So you're restoring native habitat. And there's a cultural component to this too. This is a living building in New Zealand, the Tua. Built this, it's a living building parliament where they gather and they celebrate their culture, and there's an amazing documentary if you want to watch that, Ever the Land, describing that process and that challenge. Urban ag is number two imperative. It means a portion of the footprint has to be dedicated to growing food. And this is not that hard. Okay, we got roofs. There are people that do green roofs. Captures water. It keeps your building insulated. So even in very dense urban areas, you can do that. This is my vertical garden at home. So if you have a tight space, you can do stuff with very little space. I can grow 100 plants there with 40 gallons of water, just recirculating the water over the roots. You can throw fish in there and have another source of protein, lots of creative ways. Imperative three is habitat exchange. So inevitably, we're going to have some kind of footprint. And since we want to have at least half our lands for every other species on the planet, we offset that footprint by putting an equitable footprint into conservation in perpetuity. Imperative four is human-powered living. It recognizes the destruction of putting vehicles first in our design, right? We can't walk anywhere anymore. You need a car to get A and B. We've paved everything over. So this puts the human power first. You know, your design has to implement walkability, bikeability, and facilitate those types of human behaviors. Water, I'm going to focus quite a bit on. This affects us tremendously here. And there's only one imperative, net positive water. Essentially, you collect all of your water needs on site, you treat it on site, and that addresses stormwater, gray water, which is your sinks, showers, and washing machines, and black water, which is your toilet water. Stormwater is going to be picked up from imperative one. When you restore habitat, and that water comes rushing down, it gets filtered out, it slows down, it gets absorbed into the ground, it recharges the aquifer. If you just have a paved surface, it's gonna pick up all the contaminants from that surface, rush into the stormwater drain, out onto the coral reef. Gray water, basically your sinks and showers, you can just irrigate the land outside. You can have manufactured wetlands. To filter out, just basically using natural processes. No chemicals here, just natural process to filter the water. You could reuse it, assuming you get that's legal to code. They're having a bit of challenges with that. But treating your gray water can be easy to do. And then black water, my favorite. Black water is basically somebody designed, thought it was a good idea many, many years ago, that when we go to the bathroom, we should use 5 gallons of potable drinking water to take it away from the house. Somehow that was good design. And so if we go to the bathroom 5-6 times a day, we're basically flushing away 40 gallons of perfectly good drinkable water. And where does it go? Sometimes to the injection wells, to our wastewater treatment plants. So just using composting toilets, non-water toilets, could reduce a household water consumption by 40,000 gallons per year. So we keep hearing about our water issues. We got to get the water out of the toilet system. Now, I'm on board with that. I'm sure a lot of people in this room cringe, right? You think of an outhouse. Those aren't composting toilets. Composting toilets don't smell. They don't attract flies, anything like that. But I'm not saying this is an easy sell, okay? We have a problem in a world that's called fecophobia. Somehow we taught ourselves that if we eat stuff, when we put stuff in our body, it comes out as toxic waste, and you don't want to be anywhere near it. So we have to address fecophobia. We know about shark phobia, right? You're well aware of that. People are terrified to get in the water because they may get attacked by a shark, right? But compared to you getting killed by getting in your car driving to the beach, it's non-comparable. So it's an irrational fear as well, and that applies to fecophobia. So if there's one thing that you take away from my talk today, I hope it's this. All right, I hope you remember, do not be afraid of your poo, because it'll solve a lot of our problems. And there's a great book, if you really want to get knowledgeable about your poo, The Human Air Handbook. They've sold like 60,000 copies around the world, 59 different countries. I learned a tremendous amount. It's funny, it's great. We all need to be educated a little more. Remember the Bullet Center, 6-story office building, all composting toilets? So this is one of the systems they could be. It all goes down in the basement, it's all dry, no water use. And then maybe once or twice, I think every 2 years, they take the compost away. So not only are you eliminating waste, you're actually creating nutrients. And we have such a soil erosion or a degradation issue here. All of that nutrition, the nitrogen, the phosphorus, all of that could be put back into the soil. This is an asset that we're flushing down with another limited asset with water. You can get some real fancy ones. You can't even tell you got a composting toilet, right? Or if you're curious and you're a bit on a budget, you can get the $20 version from Amazon. But let's talk. I'm not saying there are no risks, okay? There are pathogens, but it's nothing different than like working with raw chicken, right? If you're not smart, you can get sick. So let's talk about the pathogens, human pathogens. They live in our bodies at a certain temperature. When they're not in that temperature, they don't survive very long. So it could be a higher temperature or a lower temperature. So at these temperatures, you can see that'll kill every pathogen poses a threat to us anyway. So when we talk about composting, I'm talking about thermophilic composting. And how complicated is that? It's basically you put a carbon source on top. It could be dried leaves, sawdust, wood shavings. It could be a number of things, carbon source. Real easy, you get everywhere, and you basically cover it, that's it. You put another dump, you put your green waste in there too, your garden, your kitchen waste, and you cover it with carbon. No flies, no smell, the stuff cooks. And that this is my elegant version in the back of the house. You can use a garbage can. It's almost at 160 degrees Fahrenheit. So remember, at 150, in 1 minute, everything is died, kills. So this is not a complex thing you've got to turn and do a lot with. It's very easy. And it doesn't mean you have to do this at your house, but somebody, I'm sure, is willing to take that compost as a commodity. So not to belabor the point, but don't be afraid of your poo. Here's a living building in New York City. This is a wastewater treatment, no chemicals. Okay, butterflies flying around, it's all naturally treated. They have a yoga studio in there. They encourage people to breathe deeply in their wastewater treatment plant. It's a beautiful building. Let's move on to energy, the third petal. Okay, this addresses, obviously, the carbon issue we're having that's affecting climate change and acidifying our oceans. There's only one imperative here, net positive energy. That means no combustible fuel source. It's all solar or renewables, 100% renewables. Okay, the amount of energy we use in our buildings represents 41% of the energy we use. So by generating all your energy on site, we're going to take care of almost half of the energy we use in our lives. Another thing, I put this up here because we are all familiar with the fire situation in California and what's been happening West Maui. Those fires got to start with a spark. We don't have lightning here, very rare. Okay, probably 80% are the power lines. Okay, it's very hard if those power lines run in remote areas, it's hard to keep it clear. And those high voltage lines, you get a heavy wind, all you need is one branch to fall down and create that spark. So if we really want to address the fire issues here, we need to address the power lines. And if people are generating their own energy, we can start to address that as well. Now, it's not just a matter of putting a whole bunch of solar panels. It's about the efficiency as well. A typical building the size of the Bullitt Center would use 92 energy units. I forget, my notes aren't up here, but EUIs. They got it down to 13. Okay, it just gives you an idea how inefficient we are with our buildings and our energy usage. So it's both a matter of creating the renewable, but being efficient and retrofitting our buildings so they are efficient. Other places might scale up. So instead of one building, it may be a community. And here they use ground pumps, heat pumps. Sorry, I forget what they're doing. But anyway, the temperature in the ground is constant, I think about 50, 60 degrees. So if you live in a very cold climate, you pump that air down, it'll naturally heat up. Same in a hot summertime, you just pump it down, it'll naturally cool down. So lots of innovative ways to do passive heating and cooling. The fourth petal, health and happiness, that's addressing the physical and psychological health and well-being of the occupants in these buildings. Three imperatives here. They're pretty obvious. The first one is a civilized environment, imperative 7. Basically means everyone in that building needs to have access to fresh air and natural daylight. It means the windows gotta be able to open. Okay. Imperative 8, healthy interior environment. It means the air that's being circulated needs to be tested. You'd be surprised how bad the air is in most buildings. They're worse than the most polluted cities outside air in the world. So that needs to be tested and maintained. And the third imperative, number 9, is a biophilic environment. We all love ocean views, right? Want the house with the mountain view or the ocean view. We love to have little water features in our house. We're innately attached to the environment, to nature. Okay, people in hospitals heal quicker, they get discharged faster if they have a window that can see outside. This is all scientifically. So they're saying bring that nature into the design of the building, you get healthier people, people concentrate better, their performance is better. So the biophilic component is important to incorporate. Materials, this is the toughest one. This is the fifth petal and has 5 imperatives under it. The red list means no toxic materials. Okay, you know that new car smell, that new house smell, right? Those are volatile chemicals coming out of the carpets, coming out of the paints, coming out. This is stuff going into your bodies, impacting your immune system, your children's immune system. They may be carcinogenic. So this says you cannot use what we call red listed materials. There's over 800 of them. You think of plywood, right? Plywood's made with formaldehyde. Okay, now I think Home Depot sells a one without formaldehyde, but you'd be surprised how much nasty stuff is in what we build. And that is emanating fumes after construction is done and you're absorbing it, your children absorbing it. The embodied carbon footprint, that's imperative 11. Basically, the stuff you use to build your building will have had a carbon footprint from somewhere else, as well as the transportation. So we understand there's carbon embodied in there, so you have to offset it with some approved carbon offsets, basically another industry that'll take that carbon back out of the air. And imperative 12 is responsible industry. Okay, all your wood must come from the Forest Stewardship Council. Okay, that's sustainable. We know that wood is sustainably harvested. Your stone needs to be certified by the Natural Stone Council, things like that. So you're not taking away that at least those practices of where your materials come from are sustainable. And you also have to have declare label. What that is, essentially, you want to know what you're eating. You read the ingredients on the package, right? You know exactly what you're putting in your body. This is a transparent label on the building. You want to know what chemicals, what red list chemicals are in your building, where that came from, what the end life is of those materials. You put that declare label on your building. And imperative 13, living economy sourcing, recognizes, again, the transportation of it coming a long ways away. That's going to impact the carbon footprint. So they encourage locally sourced. I think about 20% should be locally sourced. It invests in local economies, and it minimizes the impact of transportation. Us in Hawaii, we're going to have challenges with that one for sure. And then net positive waste. Basically, that's getting into the mindset that there is no waste. First, we want to keep stuff out of the landfill, but either reuse, repurpose, find a way, you know, either your waste becomes somebody else's construction materials, but closing that loop. So 90% should be diverted from the landfills. Okay, the last two petals, equity, which addresses there's four imperatives, and here, let's run through them. 15, human scale and human places, similar to what we talked about. Instead of being car-centric and having these massive shopping malls you can't even get past, you have to build at the human scale. So there's limits to the size of parking lots, the streets have to be people-oriented, things like that, maximizing block size. So the focus is on the person, not the car. Universal access to nature and place. We've all seen what happens over the years. Public spaces get gated off, right? People no longer have access to the shoreline, to the beaches. So this is everyone has access. All the public spaces in that development, equal access to anybody, even if you're have handicapped or other special needs, you're basically addressing that. So they can access natural waterways, sunlight, air, all of that stuff. Equitable investment is number 17. That recognizes that there are groups out there that are struggling. Okay, they don't have maybe the ability, and we want this regenerative growth to touch all communities, even those that are perhaps disenfranchised. So there's a small offset to a charitable cause to deal with that. The last two, just organizations, again, to address all the companies that are working on this project. You need at least one company to have a just label. Again, the just label basically provides transparency in your company and looks at diversity, worker benefits, equity, safety, stewardship, those type. It just, again, it brings these social impacts to the table for every project, every development, and gets companies thinking about this. So we're down to the last pedal, which is beauty. And the reason this is in here is to address sort of the inspiration behind it. So beauty is a bit eye of the beholder. So there can be a cultural component, maybe an art component to it. But you're trying to inspire. You're trying to get people to protect what they care about. So it has to be beautiful. And the last one is education. We want to inspire and educate. So once a year, that project needs to have an open house so people can come and learn about the frameworks of how they did this, how much did it cost, and learn from the successes of these groups. So that's it. That's the ingredients for a living building challenge. Meet those 20 criteria, and you have a net positive project. This can be applied to new buildings, can be renovating old buildings, and even to green spaces. Now, I realize this is a tall order. All 20 imperatives, that's a lot to ask for. So they do have stepwise certifications to help you get there. I don't have my notes here, so I forget his name. The reason I put this slide up here, remember the 4-minute mile? Nobody, everyone, I think it was back in 54, I think. And I forget his name. Roger Bannister, there you go. So there were physicians that published articles that it's physiologically impossible for a human being to break the 4-minute mile, right? And when he did it, I think he held the record for like 45 days. And then people started breaking it. So that goes to the living building challenge. Same thing. People say, there's no way you'll ever get to that. And he's done it. The Institute has done it. And now we have, you know, here's a beautiful office in Chicago. Here's a child care center. These are all living buildings certified. This is the botanical garden. They made the roof look like an orchid petal. This is in Vancouver. Design center in Dalton, Georgia. You get pavilions in Texas, dojo in Boston. Imagine working in a building like this. Look at all the natural light. This is an environmental center in Virginia Beach. And we got our very own here in Hawaii. The Hawaii Prep Academy is a living building certified. You see that weird looking roof? So they don't get a lot of rain. This is Kamuela on the Big Island. Don't get a lot of rain there, so they condensate all of that temperature fluctuation. It condensates the water. They capture that in a gutter down at the bottom. But we do have a living building, even here in Hawaii. And they're growing. They're all 113 certified projects around the world, over 600 now registered. So people understand how to do it. They can do it at the cost of regular building, and it's kind of taking off. Whether you're in a cold climate, tropical climate, they're doing them all over the place. 29 countries. So now what? So my proposal is a couple of things. With this information, I want to hold workshops so that we educate our planners, our council members, so they understand that this exists. People are doing this everywhere. They're doing it at cost. So we need to ask developers, why can't we meet a net positive zero? And there are going to be obstacles. I know that. I know we have a planner in the audience today. Thank you for coming. And they'll tell me all about the code. And now you can't do that with today's code. But that's part of working through this. And they've done this in other communities. But workshops where they can understand how people are doing this is important. You need policy to incentivize developers to do all of this. So who's going to write the policy? Well, it's already been written because they're implementing it in lots of communities. All we have to do is plug in Hawaii or County of Maui into that slot. Okay, and it can go into maybe fits into our climate resilience policy, wherever it can fit. But it's already been written, and the incentives are there. Maybe they're fast-tracking a project if you get to a certain level. Maybe you reduce fees or other types of stuff. So they've worked through a lot of these challenges since 2014 when this was implemented. And I would also add this as a last thing. I think when our decision makers are evaluating a project, it can be very challenging to know, is this a good project? How less bad is it? But if you had the 20 imperatives and you could ask developers, well, how come you didn't meet the urban ag? How come you're not meeting the traffic issue? How come you're not meeting the net positive water? Imagine a project in Laniapoco and they say, hey, we're net positive water. We're going to capture all our water on site. We're not going to extract any from, it makes it easier for decision makers to evaluate and for projects to get a lot of backing, a lot of support behind it. So before you all take off, I am going to end with that slide. And I'm going to play one last video because I want to get to the manta rays. I'm not sure what you're here for. But we do have to ask this question, you know, are we doing enough to prepare our future for our children? And we have the solutions there to do it. And the reason why this is so important is because we're trying to protect all the amazing things that we saw in those videos and that we'll see here. So let's finish this. This is a video about Tala. It's a true story. It's a pretty cool thing. questions? I think there's a mic. Yes.
So, you identified six in Honolulu Bay known individuals. How many are known in the old Oahu area?
So most of the 400 are from Oahu. I'd say there's about 33 that are the young segregated juveniles that are working South Maui, and that's just today. There's a lot more than that. That's how many we have to catalog. So six at Oahu, at Honolulu. I'm not sure if any of those match. The tracking that we've done with the tags and the photo ID, we know that the adults go to Molokai, go to Lanai, go to Kauai. So it's not surprising an adult would show up in Honolulu Bay and also Oahu. It's those young ones that seem to be more restricted. So Tala is a little one. I haven't seen in the Oahu population, but the tag on her, she did show up in South Maui. So she might have crossed through Oahu.
I have two questions. One pertains to your building talk and one to the mantis. The first question is, how accessible are those workshops? How accessible would those workshops be? Because it seems like perhaps it's sort of a retraining program for a lot of developers and architects and people involved in that field. That was my question before you answered it, was how to extend the education and workshops, but how
successful
would they be for workshops?
Yeah, so the International Living Future Institute, they're a nonprofit based out of Seattle. They do workshops. They have a team that does workshops. Of course, they cost about $4,000 for a half-day workshop. So I would reach out, we're trying to work with some of the nonprofits on the island and groups to sort of have a few of these. Certainly, if they come out to Hawaii, it'd be beneficial for them to have a few on Oahu. On the other islands at the same time, but it's about 4,000 to do a half day, 4-hour workshop.
Is it kind of like the more prolific or the more widespread this mode of building is, then the more accessible it could be, kind of like any sort of sustainable technology? It's new, so it's more expensive, but as it becomes more ubiquitous, then it becomes more affordable.
Yeah, there are aspects of it that are affordable now. The energy efficiency, the renewables, that's there. The materials, some of those things, even the gray water systems. You know, until you get scale, you get enough builders that are starting to do that and build these sources of material at a bulk rate, then that's going to drive price down, as well as the code. You know, a lot of water, there's some funky codes, especially around water. So there needs, part of this recognizes that. So if you apply for a composting toilet, maybe the county doesn't give you the permit. If you get you have to try three times. They understand if you get three rejection letters, they'll qualify you. The idea behind that is to advocate for this. And then more people come on, they constantly get pressure for this. That's what helps break through the change. So yeah, this needs to spread. So there's more momentum and weight behind it.
Great, thank you. I have one more question about mantis.
Yeah.
There is Hawaiian legend about a manta ray that is Mamakua Princess Pei off of the coast of Lanaino. And it seems that there was one manta that hangs out in Manila Bay. And I'm just curious if you have that manta photographed and can recite, if they have site fidelity, basically. Does the mantis turn up in the same place over and over again, or do you tend to see the same manta kind of cruising around all Maui?
So most of my work was Oahu, and I'm familiar with a few photographs. I have a few photographed in Manele Bay. I think they're young, smaller animals, so I'm not sure the one you're talking about. But Oahu, I had some that I would see. I think I have resites maybe 90 times. So there's one large female. I'd see her pregnant every 2 or 3 years, and I'd see her regularly, where others I might see once in 10 years. So I think there are preferences for spots, and certain individuals will go there. But she may disappear. I may not see her for 6 months. But as a sighting, a resight rate within year and across years, some will be quite high and some will be low. But as far as who they're hanging out with, I found no correlations. They're not, oh, I see her with him, or these two are together a lot. There seems to be no strong ties. The only time they seem to congregate is mating season and cleaning stations and feeding.
Thank you for the talk. I want to ask, what are some good ways for a common person to promote the goals of the International Living Institute? Do you want to talk to our peers, or are there better ways that we can help?
So lots of ways. I think at the most basic, people need to just know, you know, people that have decision power, that have influence, need to start learning that this exists. I don't think a lot of people realize that they're doing this, and they're doing it at cost. So I do a lot of testifying for projects. I try to meet with council members, so if you have any people in the building industry, construction, developers, you know, asking them to, I'd be happy to meet with them, or I, you know, provide them links, do you know this is happening? So I think there's, you know, we have to reach a tipping point where this becomes sort of, you know, kind of like a lead. It took a long time for lead to get any momentum, but now it's sort of everyone accepts it and knows about it. So I think it's getting the word out, and especially if you have access to people of influence, either in development, in planning, in decision making at a higher level that is interested, let's get them. I'll get them all the materials they need. We can have workshops, and it's really getting the word out. And then the other side of it is building up the basically the naysayer, why this would never happen in Hawaii, why you would never, I want to see those lists so I can go back to the institute and say, how did you guys deal with gray water systems? How did you deal with composting toilets? How do you deal with materials? That's a tough one. You know, we're in the middle of the Pacific, we're far away from that. So to come back and say, this is how we can address it. This is how they were successful in Oregon and here dealing with these issues. It's very long.
Very inspiring talk, and I'm so thankful to know that there is something in place to we can use as a goal for future planning for building on Maui and around the world. But I was curious to know, what is the average lifespan of a manta ray? And I'm wondering what your what the thoughts are on what has happened to the manta ray population, having migrated out to outer islands where there's cleaner environments, or, you know, have you seen any evidence that of sickness amongst our population?
Kind of one of the first part of the question. The lifespan, yes. So the only thing we know about the lifespan is basically the first one that's ever been photographed, the oldest one that's been photographed, and that's still living today. And that would be on the Big Island. I think there's one, I think they call her Big Mama, maybe 43 years old or something. So we know they live that long. Beyond that, there's no way to tell. The other question, why they might have disappeared from Oahu, it's a good question. I have no evidence the population has declined necessarily. It may be they have shifted somewhere else. I do know that was a cleaning station. So they went there for the cleaner wrasse primarily, the Hawaiian cleaner wrasse. And those disappeared, probably because the degradation of the reef. So I think those are connected. They may be just outside of that area. I don't know, but I think that as far as them moving, we do know they go within Maui Nui. And even though populations like in Japan and Australia make travel hundreds of miles, hundreds of kilometers, there's a big population on the Big Island, not as big as Maui's. But there's about 280 or so photographed there. They've been doing dives with them for decades. well-known population. None of them match the Maui population. And we have genetics from both populations that's showing there's not a lot of interchange. So it seems like, kind of like the spinner dolphins, we have kind of the Maui Nui. They treat the four islands, probably because it's so shallow in the middle, as one big island. And they don't integrate too much with the big island spinner. Same with the mantas. It looks like they got enough of what they need here that they don't interchange. Now that's problematic for management, because if one population drops, it's not necessarily going to be supplemented by the other. So you have to manage each island population separately.
Thanks for the talk. I'm just curious, so as far as with the living buildings, it's awesome to be planning ahead for new developments, but with the current buildings, like all the big hotels and residences, who and how, if anybody, is approaching them to make changes and upgrades? Is that something that's happening with the Living Future Institute, or are you guys focusing primarily on new and upcoming developments?
No, a lot of that is renovating. So the idea is to maximize places that are already been built up. So you want to, it's a lot of infill where you have, you have to retrofit it so it's walkable, so you have to reintroduce native habitat. But you can take old buildings, like a lot of the energy side of it is good for the bottom line. So, and it's picking up, people are recognizing their buildings are so inefficient that if they get a better envelope on there and they can contain the temperature better, switch to renewables, they're getting a great return on investment. So definitely there's a huge side from the retrofit of existing buildings that can make a massive difference, water, energy, all those things. And so it's growing. People are realizing now that it's not just the right thing to do, but it's good for the bottom line. And so a lot of them are looking at that more and getting retrofits done to their existing buildings.
That's awesome, they're responsive. And then I have a second question if no one else has one. As far as like the biggest culprits for polluting the water, like would it be the hotels on the coastline? Would it be new residential areas? Is it sediment runoff? Is it the injection wells? Like what's the top 1 to 3 culprits that we should be trying to address and get them to change their behavior?
Yeah, that's a really tough question. I think you ask 10 scientists, they'll all give you different answers. I have my personal, just from, I think the sediment side of things. Sediment is so bad. And if it's an area, Honolulu, the reason that's doing pretty good is there's big wave action. So when all that mud comes in, it turns it over, flushes it out. But places like Oahu, there's not a lot of wave action, that it will sit, and it just takes one massive event to have that sediment sit there and kill the reef. So I would put my money on the sediment issue and probably related to the fires more so than, now you mentioned the coastline building, as we refrain from retreating as the ocean moves in, if we decide we don't want to move back because it's too expensive or whatever and we're going to hold the line, then you really disrupt that natural coastline. You have wave action that can stimulate more sediment issues and wave energy issues. So there are issues there. And water quality, if you want in third, that's huge. All the runoff, all the stormwater runoff, not only is it taking the sediments, it's taking all the pollutants that are coming down, whether it's just herbicides, pesticides, fertilizers, all the petrochemical stuff. Everything we spray around our homes and industries, that's that water quality. And that affects everything you're doing. If you're trying to do artificial reefs to regenerate reefs, if you're trying to repopulate fish, if you don't deal with the water quality issue, you're always going to have that toxic environment no matter what you try to do. So I think sediment is a major, major issue.
Mark over here. Hi, Mark. Thanks very much for your presentation. Excellent presentation. Obviously, this is it's fairly new. It builds on lead, and it is. I think we all recognize that we know more now than we did 20 years ago. Like when you came, all of our collective experience here, everything Maui Nui Resource Council is doing. So it really. All of this is almost a generational change, right? A next generation. You know how, and certainly we can incorporate a lot of these ideas currently, but how is it? What is the direction of the Living Future Institute to institutionalize these concepts into, say, the university system or their efforts? Within UH or, you know, say the Seattle area or other places like that, how is their institutional approach taken?
Thanks, Jim. Jim's one of our planners. We're very lucky to have Jim on our side here at Maui County. But and thanks for coming, Jim. That's a good question. I actually don't know the answer to that. I know they go the nonprofit route. They work a lot with communities and planners and developers, and a lot with policy. They focus a whole lot on policy, getting policy to incentivize this. But to be truthful, I mean, they have an online program, and they have workshops, and they have conferences every year. But how they're tied to the university system, like can you get a degree in this stuff?
I just wanted to make an editorial comment. One of the large-scale developments that we're watching really closely here on Maui is the mechanic. They tore down the hotel, the Maui Prince Hotel, and before they got all the permits, as a result of a lawsuit, they settled the lawsuit and agreed to do a bunch of different things to make the impact of their development much less stressful on the nearshore environment. They're doing things like, or they've committed to do things like use permeable pavers so that they can increase water infiltration and reduce runoff and to do what they call complete streets so that they can, again, keep water from running into the ocean and get that water and filter it, rain gardens. They've lowered the heights of their buildings. They've adjusted it to support preserving viewplanes from the streets to the ocean. They've made a whole bunch of promises. They're not far enough along in their project yet for us to know whether they're going to keep their promises, but they made these promises, and we have means that we could use to hold them to it. So that would be kind of that's the test that I'm watching for, to see how well we as a community and as a development organization, I'm not part of them, but how well they will do at keeping those promises and giving us something of a model that we can use to say, look, they did it, why can't you do it? So it's not nothing to do with this per se, but it should be the most advanced and most environmentally sensitive project that we have seen here, if they deliver. Thank you.
Yeah, and if I could add just a couple things. So I do think we need the pilot project. We need that developer that's willing to get the first one on the map here so we can turn to that as an example to how it can get done. A couple of things I didn't mention, too. All of these buildings have to be able to break it down. So it's a closed loop system. So when we're dealing with retreat, if they were building these back in the day, we've come a long way, we've learned a lot. These are all built in a way they can be disassembled if they need to and retreated and moved should that be needed. And I'll add one thing. When we think there are a lot of people doing the next level of smart growth, complete streets, things like that, multi-use. I'll just put this out there. If I was to make a toy for your children that maybe has a 20% chance of causing cancer, probably not appropriate. If I said, well, I can probably get it down to 10%, you know, that's great. It's better. It's less bad. But is it really appropriate? Are we okay with just being less bad? That's the question I would leave, because there are a lot of progressive people, and I don't fault them for trying, but if we're going to turn this around and we're going to have a future, a living future that we want to pass on to the children, we got to turn the curve the other way. We can't just slow it down. We have to start regenerating. We start have fixing and healing the damage that we've done. So I just leave that out there, because I know we're 10 steps behind, and if we can just get one step higher, we're all happy about that. We need to get the positive trend if we're going to get this under control. Just throwing it out.
I think we have time for one more question, and then Mark will be here afterwards.
Mark, thank you for your talk. I had a question about when a manta ray throws itself out of the water. What is that?
Good question. Some parts of the world, they do it regularly. I rarely see it here. I filmed one once in Guam, and it was just a male-female chasing one. I think probably has to do with parasites and removing. There may be a communication component. We don't know much about. They don't vocalize, so we don't think they have much acoustic capability. We know marine mammals do it for acoustics. Whales breach for acoustics, and probably part parasite removal. I think it's more parasite removal thing, personally.
Okay.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Mark.